There's some phases in this learning. And as we'll see, some types of learning happen in one trial. Doesn't happen that way when you're trying to get a dog to slobber to food. Or when you're trying to get you to learn material for a test. Or you're trying to get people to learn behaviors for their job. It takes time, over and over and over again. I ring the bell, I get food. Then I ring the bell, I don't get slobbered the first time. Ring the bell, get food, 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 ring the bell, get food. I do it over and over and over. During this period of acquisition, acquiring this association, and at its peak level, I can ring the bell, not present the food, and I get salivation. Therefore, I have acquired a classically conditioned response. But, dog's not dumb, right? If I keep ringing the bell and I keep giving no food, eventually the bell doesn't predict food anymore, right? Ring the bell, no food, 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 on and on until the dog has learned not to salivate to the bell anymore. Right, this is a period of extinction. So it seems like our conditioned behavior is gone. And I'm going to show you how this is important in other areas of your life besides dogs. But some time emits, right, gets gone by, time goes by. Could be 2 days, 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 years. Whatever the case may be, I have time going by and I can ring that bell again. Now, this is assuming I haven't rang the bell and given food again, and that dog will salivate one more time. Spontaneously, seems random, the recovery of the conditioned reaction. Spontaneous recovery of a conditioned behavior. Ring the bell, but you'll see I don't get full on. You see that? I don't get a full response like I did at peak conditioning, but I get a response. Now, at this point, critical distinction. If I do not provide the unconditioned stimulus, if I do not give food, then the next time I ring the bell, it'll go away and stay away longer. Go away quicker and stay away longer. However, if I give the unconditioned stimulus, if I give it here at this point of spontaneous recovery, ring the bell, dog salivates, a half response or so, I give the food, then the next time I ring the bell, I'm back to pre-extinction levels of behavior. It relearns it more quickly, which is adaptive, right? It doesn't have to go through this long old process of relearning everything. It instantly returns to that peak state of conditioning, which means it acquires that behavior again rather quickly, and you have to extinguish it through the same procedures. Now, here's the thing. Drug addiction is a terrible problem in our society. I know a lot of addicts. I used to be an alcoholic and a pothead, gave that stuff up, but that wasn't easy to do. A lot of the people I know were addicted to all kinds of other things. I was addicted to cigarettes and nicotine and things of that nature as well. And nobody that I ever knew, and myself included, ever said, man, I can't wait to be an addict when I grow up. I'm going to be the best addict you ever seen. I'm going to trash my family, lose my job, have everybody hate me, and get arrested if I can. People just don't operate like that, right? They don't see it that way. They don't think they're going to get addicted, right? If they knew it was coming, they wouldn't do it. And when we get them to the point where they are ready for treatment, they admit there's a problem, you get them convinced to go do something, we take them into a rehab facility. But here's the thing. Classical conditioning matters a lot.
Man, we're getting right up on the end here. You know what, though? That's all right. When you're in your daily state of affairs, up and downs happen all the time, little bits in there and there. You get a little up, you get a little down, but you stay in your little bounds. That's normal for you, right? What happens if you take cocaine? Woo! Way up. Way, way up. What happens if you take heroin? Ooh. Way down, baby. Way, way down. Now, I never did those two drugs, but I hung out with people who did, and that seems to be a pretty accurate representation to me. But you don't stay up, do you? You come down.
You come down not to where you started, right? But below where you started. In other words, you start having a hangover. You start getting cravings. This is an opponent process. Your body is now counteracting the drug's effect by taking you physiologically into the opposite state, which feels bad. But what happens if you take more of the drug? That badness goes away. Feels better. But maybe you don't get as high next time. And your body then starts anticipating. Now let's say you stop partying, you've recovered, and you go on about your business, and you wind up in a very similar situation to where you did the drug, whether it's nicotine, caffeine, heroin, or cocaine, or alcohol. And guess what your body starts doing? Makes you go in the opposite direction, anticipating that you're about to administer the unconditioned stimulus. And we'll talk about it in depth next time, and y'all have a good day. Here we go back into this other material that's so important into your daily life. And I know it seems hard to understand that sometimes. I started talking about acquisition, extinction, spontaneous recovery. These both apply to classical and operant conditioning. We talked about slobbering dogs. We talked about neutral stimuli becoming conditioned stimuli. And now let me give you a little bit of a stronger point. Started talking about drug addiction and how that works. And ultimately, why relapse is so common. In other words, why it's so hard to get people successfully off of addictions once they've become addicted. Let's see if I can get it to brighten up there. Come on, light. There it is. All right. So, I started drawing you a pretty little drawing. Looks something like that. That's your arousal level. That's your mood. That's your state of consciousness on any given day. Little up, a little down from one day to the other. And we talked about if you did cocaine, you'd go, woo, up. Right? If you did heroin, you'd go, ooh, down. Both associated with some pleasurable experiences, which is why people tend to do them again. But also, when you go up, you must come down. Right? It ain't gonna stay like that. As the dose wears off, dose dependent effect, you don't go back just to normal. You actually go into the opponent state, opposite, and it doesn't feel good. So if you're going from high to low, now you got people being really agitated, really irritable, very unpleasant feelings physically, and that's a state of craving, right? And if you know anything about, I mean, people who have had alcohol, too much of it, we'll understand that to be what phase? Hangover. What gets rid of a hangover? Aside from water and aspirin and thyme. Hair of the dog that bit you. A little bit more of the unconditioned stimulus. That's what we're talking about. That's the UCS. It'll bring you back up, maybe to normal, but your body starts to associate the unconditioned stimulus, the actual administration of the drug, with other environmental stimuli that were previously neutral. And over time, because of this opponent process, you know, you use more, if you use the same amount, you might not get as high. And then you're down even further, and you may not get as high, and then you're down even further, and now you're using the drug not to get high, but to get normal, right? Normal. So what's happening? The base brain involved in classical conditioning is starting to predict when you're going to take the drug by associating environmental factors that become conditioned stimuli to trigger cravings, which are then alleviated by administration of the drug. So you take somebody and you take them into rehab. Bring back up our other thing here. What do they got? Acquisition phase. Just like ring the bell, give food, ring the bell, give food, ring the bell, give food, right? We're taking the drug in an environment, taking the drug in an environment, taking the drug in an environment. Eventually, the environment itself starts off the craving. Why? Because the body doesn't like to be out of homeostasis, so it tries to prepare by taking you in the other direction before you administer the drug, so that when you take it, you won't go so far out of homeostasis in the other direction.
So you go to rehab. If you go to rehab and you don't get any more of the unconditioned stimulus, right? If I ring the bell, no food, ring the bell, no food, ring the bell, no food, eventually dog stops salivating, right? But if I take you into rehab and you have the internal stimuli, maybe the way you feel about yourself, or for people who use drugs, certain kinds of other kind of environmental stimuli, people who smoke cigarettes, for example, feel powerful craving maybe after a meal, or maybe when they get in their car. In other words, the meal itself then triggers the craving. Getting in the car triggers the craving. The environmental stimulus that used to be neutral with regard to cravings now causes the craving, and the use of the drug alleviates the craving. So you have all these cravings get extinguished. And at the end of 28 days or whenever it is that you get out, you don't have people going, man, I can't wait to be an addict again, any more than they said that to begin with. Usually, assuming that they want to get better, they are empowered. They are encouraged. There are people telling them, man, you've done it. Look at you go. You've been a month. Now, don't go back to any of your old haunts or any of your old friends, which seems a little insane as a piece of advice. They don't explain why. They just say, don't hang out. Well, that'll be a trigger to set you off on relapse, but they don't explain why. Why is this? Because when you go back to the place that you used to do the drug, you haven't extinguished those cues. And you get a spontaneous recovery of that craving, right? So ring the bell, no food, ring the bell, no food. Some period of time goes by, I can ring the bell and I'll get salivation, even though it's been extinguished. And as I said the other day, right, if I don't give food, it'll go away quicker and stay away longer. But if I give the unconditioned stimulus, the next time I ring the bell, I'm going to get a full-blown salivation response. Yep. Now, after rehab, some period of time, I go home and I get the craving, but I don't know what it is and I don't know why I'm experiencing it. I just got out of rehab. Aren't I over that by now? And all of a sudden I get feeling that feeling again. And what gets rid of that feeling? A little of the unconditioned stimulus, the drug. Most people don't go, man, I'm going to become an addict again. They go, I just need one bump or one drink or one hit or one toke to get me through this rough patch and then I'll be okay. And what they don't know is this. If they can resist it, willpower is involved, because if they didn't cave and they didn't use the unconditioned stimulus, that craving would go away quicker and stay away longer in more situations. But not being taught this information at all, they naively assume that they'll just get past this little rough patch and they'll be okay because they got all that sobriety behind them. But if they have that craving and they administer the unconditioned stimulus, which is the drug, the next time in that situation, bam, it comes back as though they had never been to rehab. And then they don't know what the hell happened to them. They think they're a failure. They think they're no good. They come up with all these self-fulfilling prophecies ultimately to say, well, I can't do it, obviously, so I might as well not even try. And it becomes easy to justify falling off that wagon, right? But it's interesting. It happened to me with cigarettes. I saw it and didn't know what it was. It was before I went to community college. I smoked and I smoked and I smoked and I smoked and I drank, and I had a cross addiction. So in other words, drinking made me want a cigarette. Having a cigarette made me want to drink. And eventually I was able to give up the cigarettes without giving up the drinking. That was a different kind of problem. But I went a while without smoking, and I could be around people that I knew that smoked and I didn't feel the craving anymore. The cravings had been extinguished to all kinds of things because I'd gotten over them. I hadn't gratified with a cigarette. And months and months go by, maybe even a year, and my friend Boo comes back in town. He'd been gone because his band went out to California. They got signed. They went on a tour. And they came back, and it was his grandmother's basement. Loved Boo. Used to hang out and party with Boo in his grandmother's basement. Grandma was cool as could be. And all of a sudden, visiting him, just sitting there drinking, he's smoking Marlboro Lights, which is what I used to smoke predominantly. And I get this craving, this overwhelming sense that I want a cigarette. And I'm like, man, let me get one of those cigarettes from him. He's like, dude, have all you want. I'm like, no, I don't smoke. I don't smoke. I'll just take one. He's like, whatever. Gives me one. About 20 minutes later, I'm like, let me get one more of those if you don't mind. Oh, Boo, have all you want. No, I don't smoke. And the next day I found myself buying a pack of cigarettes. Had no idea what the hell just happened, and I'm a smoker again. What happened was I'd extinguished all those cues but Boo.
and grandma's basement. Now I went back into a situation that hadn't been extinguished. It brought about a craving, and I administered the unconditioned stimulus such that I was back to cravings and all of the other circumstances in which I had extinguished them, and found myself powerless to do anything. So when people try to explain drug addiction and why people don't get better, they like to go for the easy explanation. Well, they don't want to get better, or they're just no good. But it's far more complicated than that. Far more complicated than that. And I hope you get appreciation for how that applies. Let me put one more example out there for you in terms of conditioned stimuli and how powerful this phenomena is in this particular context. And it's this. Bunch of addicts in New York were having all these near-death experiences, overdoses, and unusual proportions. Those who survived it, you could interview. Those who didn't survive, you couldn't interview, obviously, but you could interview people that knew them. Researcher goes and finds out from these interviews that most of these addicts, they're using heroin, are not using amounts that they had not previously used. They're using similar amounts, right? And you can't control for what content is. You don't know how much it's been stepped on or how pure it is, but it doesn't seem like there's really any difference in the distribution of the drug, so it should be about the same stuff in terms of its quality and quantity. And all of a sudden, they're having these overdoses. Well, if you know tolerance, once you've tolerated it, it doesn't become deadly. That's the body counteracting it. And through other mechanisms like increasing enzymes in the liver, trying to eliminate the drug faster, in case of alcohol, cytochrome P450, right? But what he did find consistent was that when they had their overdoses, they had taken the drug in places they had never taken it before. Right? Never taken it before. What does that imply? Well, the conditioned stimuli that had been preparing their bodies in the place they usually took it was not present in the new novel place. Their bodies weren't ready for it, and they got a full drug effect. Is it all in the mind? What the hell isn't all in the mind? Everything's all in the mind. It's a complicated psychophysiological process. That's all nice and anecdotal. So he took it to the lab, and he took rats, and he had these rats injected with heroin, right? That's animal studies, not pleasant, but it tells us something here. He had them then titrated up from small doses up to LD50, lethal dose 50%, where if you administer that to a population that had no experience with the drug, 50% would die. He did it always in the same exact cage. And then he took one group and put them in a brand new cage that they'd never been in, administered the same dosage, and half of them died. What's the power of the mind, all right? It was the conditioned reaction that they didn't get because they didn't have those stimuli triggering the body going into an opponent process, which would be experienced by humans as craving for the drug, to offset the actual effect of the drug, and physiologically, they died. So it's a powerful thing we're talking about here. Slobbering dogs doesn't really cut it for most people, but when you put it in that kind of term, it makes a lot more sense.